Well, the first thing is to really understand that we've been programmed. And, you know, most people see the movie The Matrix. Yeah. And you think, well, The Matrix is a science fiction movie, but it's actually a documentary. And that the issue is that our lives are really coming from the program and not from our deepest wishes and desires. So once we understand the difference between the programming and our conscious mind, which is really where we live, then we begin to take an opportunity to let go of the program and start to live from your deepest wishes, desires, and aspirations. And you can change your life instantaneously with this process. One of the most important things, because the subconscious mind really has fundamental programs of life that we acquire from our parents, our family, our community, between the last trimester of pregnancy and the first 7 years. So this is why nature created the first 7 years of a child's life to download how to be a member of a family and a society and a culture by strictly observing other people. It's actually a brain function. It's equivalent of hypnosis.
Yes.
Okay? So the fundamental programs, your subconscious, are not yours. The conscious mind is yours. That's the creative mind. Well, the issue is that the conscious mind can travel in time. What are you doing next week?
Yeah.
Your mind lets go, the moment goes to next week. What did you do last week? Let's go the moment. And you move into last week, or I say, I think it's something in your head. And the moment you're thinking, you're not paying attention. Well, this is what the function of the subconscious comes in. When you're not paying attention, you go to autopilot. So it's not like you're walking down the street and you have a thought and then stop. Like that. No, you continue walking. Yeah, but you're not paying attention. So it's a subconscious that does all the jobs from walking to driving the car. And so why is this relevant? Because when we're not paying attention and we default to the subconscious, we play the programs that are in the subconscious. And then I go, yeah, but the programs in the subconscious are primarily not yours. They came from other people. And most of them, as psychologists tell us, most of the programs we get are disempowering, self-sabotaging, and limiting. Yes. And the relevance about that is this. If I'm going to play those programs, then by definition, I'm going to be shooting myself in the foot. The reason why you play the subconscious programs is because the conscious mind's engaged with thinking, which is 95% of the time or more. And that means 95% of your behavior is invisible to you. And why I really wanted to emphasize this so much is this, because we believe we're victims. Oh, you know, I really wanted to be successful. I wanted to be healthy. I wanted to have a great relationship, and it's not working out.
Yeah.
And then you say, well, that was my intention, and it's not working, so therefore the world's against me. And then we go into victims like, God, I really wanted it and it didn't happen. And I just wanted people to wake up, because it basically is this. It's not the world against you at all. The world will give you everything. The issue is you're not operating from your conscious mind, except 5% at the most. And so your life is really a reflection of your subconscious programming.
Yes.
Now you say to me, well, I got programmed from the last trimester of pregnancy, the first 7 years, so I was being programmed when I was 1 and 2 and 3, and I go, absolutely. And you say, but what were the programs? I wasn't there. I have no idea what the hell the programs are. And I go, here's the neat part. 95% of your life is coming from the subconscious. So all you have to do is look at your life and just look at it and say, for what? I say, what comes to you that you want and it comes to you easily, you have programs to allow that to happen. But what you struggle with, what you work hard on, what you have to put a lot of effort into, why are you working so hard? And the answer is simple. Because you have an invisible program that is sabotaging you from that point. So now all of a sudden you say, well, what do I need to change? I say, well, look at your life.
Yes.
And tell me what you're having trouble with.
Yeah.
Because that's the direct expression of a program that's not supporting you. There's always been a belief that the conscious and the subconscious minds are one and the same. So if I educate my conscious mind, then my subconscious mind should automatically know what the heck I just did.
Yeah.
Right? So then I say, well, yeah, guess what? How many self-help books did you read? And I go, oh, I read all these self-help books. I say, now that you read them, did your life change? And the answer is, no, not really. But I'm really smart, because if you ask me any questions about the self-help book, I can answer it. I say, well, what's the issue? And the issue is this. The conscious mind is creative. So yeah, I could read the book. I could watch this video with you in it. I could even just go, aha, and the conscious mind could accept that and learn it. But the subconscious mind does not learn that way. And that has been the problem, because we educate the conscious mind to get really smart, and our life stays exactly the same as it is. And the issue is why? Because it doesn't translate from the conscious to the subconscious, because the subconscious learns in, well, 3 to 4 fundamental ways. Number one, the first way it learned 7 years was hypnosis, because the brain was operating in a low vibrational frequency and just downloading what it saw. After you're 7, how do you learn? Habituation. How'd you learn the ABCs or the times table? You had to repeat it and repeat it and repeat it, and finally you got it, and then you know how to do it. You want to drive a car? You have to practice and practice, and then you learn how to do it. So if you want to change the subconscious mind, hypnosis is number one, that works. Number two, repetition, habituation. Yes. Create a habit. And at first it seems like a struggle because it's new to the subconscious mind, but hey, you didn't learn A, B, C, D the first time you said it, you know? You
That's
had to
right.
do it again and again. But after you do it for a repetition period, it will be so natural that if you're not doing it, your subconscious mind go, hey, what's happening? We're not doing it.
Yeah, yeah.
So that's really good. We overcome that. A third way, which is some people get it and it's very powerful, but I wouldn't recommend it, is tremendous emotional shock. Boom! Something happens in your life and it's so dramatic that after that moment, you're not going to be the same person. The subconscious got it right there, okay?
Yeah.
And the newer one and the better one is a whole new field of belief change modalities, which are also associated with what's called energy psychology.
Yes.
And these are wonderful because basically it's a form of super learning. And what's neat about it, the conventional things like hypnosis or habituation, there's a time element that takes a long time.
Yeah.
But these new belief change modalities, like a super learning experience, you can change a belief you've had your whole life, 50 years, and change it in 10 minutes.
Yeah.
And so this is really, it's a new type of psychology that's coming in, but it's really necessary because, as they say, necessity is the mother of invention.
Yeah.
We're running into a world that has a lot of necessity to change very, very quickly. So we're really happy to see that there are ways of changing without going through all that anxiety and stress, and we can do it really quickly. My favorite one is the one that I use because I'm the most familiar with it, but there's many of them in my books. I give a whole list, but the one I use is called psych-k, like the abbreviation of psychology.
Yeah.
It actually represents psychological kinesiology.
Yeah.
And it's an exercise where you get your right and your left brain hemispheres to work in harmony, which they don't do on a normal day-by-day basis. And when you get them to work in harmony, that's called brain synchronization, a window sort of opens up and you can drop in a new belief in 5 minutes.
Wow.
I'm a devotee of that because I wouldn't have written my book. I couldn't write my book. I tried for 15 years to write the book, and every time I get halfway through the book, it would peter out, and then I didn't realize it because my subconscious had a fear. At the time was a respected scientist, and I said, well, if you write this book and you bring in consciousness and spirit into the book, all your colleagues are going to shun you. So my subconscious was doing me a favor. It says, you don't want to do this because this will invalidate you, you know, it's like kill you. So my subconscious programming, working 95% of the day, would sabotage the writing. What I ended up doing was changing the belief about that. And then the book came out, it was just like, it just flowed right out.
Wow.
Within a few months, the whole thing was really done. You know, it's really fun because you say, well, what if you can release these programs? And that's the story of The Matrix, where I say, well, I take the red pill, I get out of the program. And then I say, yeah, but in real life, every time we've taken that red pill, I say, what's the red pill in real life? And the answer is falling in love. Falling in love with the person, or falling in love with your creativity, or whatever it is, falling in love. Because when you fall in love, what you're doing is so captivating and so engrossing and so desirable, you don't let your conscious mind wander. So the first time in your life, your conscious mind's staying present. And I said, well, why is that important? Conscious mind, wishes, desires, and aspirations. If you're operating from that mind, you manifest your wishes and desires. So my conclusion for all of this blah, blah, blah that I'm giving you is simply this. What if you go into the subconscious mind and change the programs in the subconscious mind so they reflect the wishes and desires of your conscious mind? What would that mean? And I tell you what it means. You'll live in a honeymoon for every day of your life on this planet for a simple reason.
Yeah.
If my conscious mind with wishes and desires begins to wander and I default into the subconscious and is playing my wishes and desires, I never left the honeymoon.
Good, right?
Well, absolutely, because a lot of people beforehand would say, oh, that's just a new age idea, and how do you know you've really changed? Just because you got finished with the belief process and you say, oh, I feel so much better, is that real? Well, now Jeff Fannin, a neuroscientist whose expertise is called brain mapping.
Yeah.
And he puts wires over your head and can read three-dimensionally what's going on in the brain. The moment the brain has changed, the program has changed, you can see it on the screen. So he generally puts like a person up on the stage and puts the wires on and says, okay, now we tested your belief and you don't have a belief in this, and so now let's put in the new belief. And it's interesting because the audience can see the change before the person actually says, yes, now it's done. It's maybe a few seconds, but the audience can see it. So why is this important? Because this sounds miraculous. Yes, you mean you can change your beliefs in 5 or 10 minutes?
And see the results, like,
but you can
instant.
See it instantly. Actually, you can experience it instantly if it's a phobia, for a simple reason. Because a phobia is a certain stimulus, like height, or I'm afraid of spiders, or I'm afraid of dogs. And I say, okay, good, let's go through the belief change. You come out and I say, well, how am I afraid of spiders now? I can show you instantly, here's a spider. And all of a sudden, you know, 10 minutes before, it freaks you out. Now it's like, oh, all of a sudden your complete biology changed. So you can see that.
That's, yeah.
But a lot of people's beliefs involve something dynamic. They have to do with relationship to others and people or jobs. So they actually have to go out and then they look back and go, whoa.
Yeah.
This is so different than it was before. Most people's stresses are not real immediate emergency stresses at all. They're beliefs of a fear that they won't have something. They won't have a job. They won't have food. They won't have a friend. And it's not that they don't have them right now. They're thinking about, oh, that happens. And that's where the stress comes from. And that's why 90% of the people are in fear, because they recognize that their future is uncertain, but rather than seeing it in a positive way, they have this image of a negative thing.
Work it all out.
And it's really interesting because, remember, when you fall in love and you get out of the programming, you create heaven on earth. Well, if it wasn't for the programming, everybody would have heaven on earth.
Yes.
So if we can change the programming, then heaven on earth is available.
Yes.
To anyone.